Hello. If you've been paying any attention to Rust in 2019, you would know that a lot of people are excited about async await syntax. You might also have spotted some comments saying, well, a lot of people don't really need it, or links to a blog post called What Color Is Your Function?, which is actually a pretty interesting critique of async programming in general. You don't have to go down the async path. As always, choose the right tool for the job. But what are the other tools? That's what I want to talk about in this video. Imagine you're writing a Rust library that has to do some processing or some communicating over a period of time. There are a few distinct ways that you could design your API. Futures-based async is one of those ways. I'm going to review four different styles here, which I've taken from three different crates relating to networking. I'm going to briefly describe how each one works and what I see as the main pros and cons of each one. There are other general approaches I'm not talking about, like promises and the actor models, so please don't think that I'm trying to cover everything here. These are just some of the designs that I've personally come across in popular crates. The first one is synchronous methods. This means that you call some function and it blocks your thread until it's done. I'm going to use the websocket crate as an example of a library that can be used this way. In the second style, the library uses a single thread, but internally it can share it between an arbitrary number of tasks, which you handle using callback closures. This is one of the operating modes of WSRS, which is a different crate for WebSockets. The third style is a non-blocking synchronous state machine. It shows up in crates like quiche, which is Cloudflare's Rust implementation of quiche. If you haven't seen it before, this one's a bit weird. And finally, we have futures. This could be either old school futures 0.1 code or new style futures 0.3 async await using the new futures in the standard library. I'm going to lump these all together because the interface is conceptually kind of the same, even if the syntax is a little different. Sometimes crates offer both sync and async versions of their API. Here you can see the WebSocket crate shows up twice because it has both a synchronous and a futures based API. Other libraries will often choose just one. In that case, if you want to use that particular crate, you have to fit your application code to whatever they're offering. First, let's look at the simple one, synchronous functions, functions that block. Here is a small program that connects to a WebSocket server, prints the receive messages to screen for as long as the connection lasts, then ends. Connecting to the server is an operation that takes time. Waiting to receive a message also takes time. When our program launches, it starts out with one thread, and when we call one of these functions, the WebSocket library takes over the use of our thread. Our program can't go on and do anything else until that function returns. And you know, I say that like it's a bad thing, but is it really? Our program literally has nothing else to do but to wait for the result of that function call. And also, our code is extremely easy to read. We connect, we get a message, we print it out, we loop, we get another message. Maybe eventually the connection ends and we exit. Super straightforward. But let's say we want to do two connections at once. We can still do this using this same API. Now we just need two threads, not one. So in this version of the code, we spawn a second thread to handle the first server and use our original main thread to cover the second server. Let's quickly run this in the debugger to prove what's going on. Okay, it's running and we can see those clients are both operating. So I'll hit pause. Okay, we have two threads here. This one is waiting to receive a message, and this one is waiting to receive a message. Excellent, that's what I was expecting to see. So with synchronous methods like these, the main advantage is that it's really straightforward. Your library functions can just return regular results like OK and error. If your user is only doing one thing at a time, this is perfect. And if they're doing multiple things, they can just make more threads, even hundreds or thousands of them if they have to. The downside is that threads are basically not super efficient. If you're connected and waiting for the next message, you have an entire thread sitting there occupying memory and it's just twiddling its thumbs. Also, I'm not going to back this up with numbers, but if you're making thousands of threads, you might start to notice the overhead of creating and destroying them and the time that the operating system spends switching between them. If you need to handle a large number of concurrent tasks and need absolute maximum performance, and let's be honest, many applications don't need maximum performance, but if you do, lots of threads might not be the best option. Next, I want to show you this cool thing that I saw in a different WebSocket crate, WSRS. To introduce this, let's return to this programming problem where we want to make just one connection, and we're happy to block our main program thread for it. This is roughly the equivalent of what we had before, except now in WSRS. What's funky here is that we have to supply closures. An outer closure that handles the connection result, which itself returns an inner closure that says how you're going to handle each message that you receive. The actual outer connect function that we call just sits there and blocks until the whole process is complete. So far it's the same thing that we saw before, except more confusing. But this style of API lets them do something clever when we want to do multiple connections simultaneously. In this version of the code, where we handle multiple connections simultaneously, we're going to create a WebSocket object from WSRS. We have to provide a closure that explains how we're going to handle each client once we connect. And that closure is going to return a different closure to handle the messages like before. This time though, we queue up four connection requests to four different URLs, they all happen to be the same server, and then run them simultaneously using only a single thread. Behind the scenes, WSRS will use the MIO reactor to monitor all of them for activity. So to see this going on, let's actually run this. Okay, it's clearly connected four times over because we can see we're receiving the messages from the server four times. Let me now hit pause and count our threads. Now, would you look at that? We have two, not one, just to make this more complicated. So, in fact, we are using one thread to handle all four of our clients. That's using k-event here on the Mac to monitor all our connections. And it turns out that we also have this timer, which MIO is using in the background. So there's an extra thread going on, but for the cost of one extra thread, we can now stack on as many clients as we want to. So the main advantage here is that we can maintain a lot of WebSocket tasks without the overhead of one thread per client. And it's also very simple. We get this without messing about with a thread pool and future syntax and all of that. The downside is that not all workloads are going to fit very well into this reactor model. They are able to use MIO, your code possibly can't. And, you know, the callback types with the closures that WSRS uses and their handler traits and so on, possibly a little bit unusual. So that's something you have to deal with. Third, I want to show you a non-blocking synchronous state machine. Maybe there's a shorter name I could use, but that's what it is, so that's what I'm going to call it. The idea is that we have some object that contains the current state of our network connections, but it doesn't create or manage any connections by itself. You tell the object what happened, and the object bosses you around. So here is the workflow with quiche, a quiche library. Every time we receive data, we have to pump it into the object by calling a function on it. Then we ask it repeatedly, do you have something for me to do? Yes, transmit this data. Do you have something for me to do? Yes, transmit this data. Do you have something for me to do? No, actually we're done for now. And the important thing here is that every time you call a function on this object, a method, it's just CPU work. It's following some sort of logical steps to update its internal state and maybe generating more jobs for you to do. It doesn't need to wait for anything, so you can expect it to return more or less instantly. With the quiche object, it can boss you around in a couple of ways. You can call send on it to see if there's any data to transmit. You can also call timeout, where it will tell you if it needs to be woken up after a certain amount of time. So the user of the quiche library is responsible for maintaining the network connectivity and for having some sort of timer. Overall, this is pretty weird, but it does have some advantages. For one thing, it doesn't tie you to a particular networking library or a particular threading model, because you're just moving bytes in and out synchronously. To provide timers, your application can use Threads, Tokyo, or whatever else it likes. It's also very convenient to test a library like this, because you can verify its entire behavior without needing to make any real network connections. The downside is that it feels unnatural and is a bit of a hassle to use. The developer has to do a bunch of work to make sure that all of the library's needs are correctly met. Finally, we come to futures-based async. In the earlier sections, I've been talking about having lots of threads, or just one thread, and just one falls somewhere in the middle. Futures can be used with different kinds of executors, but I think it's safe to say that in a typical async application, it will create a Tokyo runtime which has a pool of multiple worker threads. You might have 1,000 WebSocket connections active, but the work will be spread over maybe just 8 threads if that's the number of CPU cores that you have. In this code, I am once again connecting to a WebSocket server twice. When I invoke this client builder, the WebSocket library shouldn't do any connection yet. The job of this library is to create some object that implements future. And when that future is polled by the executor, it will actually create the WebSocket connection. If you're writing a futures-based library, then that's your job, to provide implementations of future and string. Normally, the caller is responsible for spawning them on the runtime of their choice. If you do find that your library needs to spawn new tasks internally or by itself, you can ask your runtime for a task executor, which serves as an entry point for spawning things onto the runtime that it came from. Since we handed our futures over to Tokyo, the main thread is actually useless. I need to give it something to do so the program doesn't exit immediately. I do that by waiting on shutdown on idle on the runtime. This blocks until all spawn tasks are finished. So in my opinion, futures code is pretty cool. It has less overhead than threads and will scale to use your CPU fully, unlike the earlier single-threaded WSRS example. So it seems that people who are writing high-performance network servers and the like are looking closely at it. Carl from Tokyo recently wrote an awesome blog post showing some really exciting performance improvements in the new version of the executor. From a coding perspective, if you make your library use futures, it means that an application developer can create just one runtime and spawn your futures and another library's futures and their own futures, and they just only need the one thread pool, which is quite nice. On the downsides, traditionally writing, you know, old Tokyo code like this is pretty weird and confusing for someone who's used to normal synchronous Rust code. Everything has to be packaged up into independent units of work that can float around in heap memory. And at the moment, that's pretty in your face. It took me a long time to get to grips with it. The new async await syntax is going to make it a lot more friendly to write async code, which is why people are so excited about it. However, just because it looks like synchronous stack-based code doesn't mean it is. Time will tell whether it's as straightforward as we hope it will be. So to recap, I've reviewed 4 different styles of API. The synchronous blocking API, which is one of the modes offered by the WebSocket crate. The closures-based API in WSRS, which had the cool ability to multiplex multiple connections onto a single thread without using futures. The synchronous state machine approach used in quiche, which avoided getting involved in networking on timers at all. And finally, the futures approach using a typical multi-threaded Tokyo runtime. None of these is obviously better than the others in every situation, and I'm sure there are other strategies that I haven't even seen. Personally, I'm quite fond of futures and I'm excited to see where they go, but hopefully nobody feels like they're being forced into a particular choice. That's all for today. Cheerio.